vary the input. For example, in the short period of time, we cannot change the technology. We cannot change the machinery. We cannot change the land in the short period of time. But in the long period, everything can be changed. New technology can be adopted. New land can be purchased. New machinery can be purchased. New setup can be built. New factory can be built. So in the long run, every input is variable. So what happens in that case? In the long run, there are three possible scenarios depending on the company, depending on the industry. There are three possible scenarios. The first scenario is that a situation in which the output doubles, output increases by more than double when the inputs are doubled. That situation is called increasing returns to scale. And if we double the input and the output is also doubling, that situation is termed as constant returns to scale. Constant returns to scale. If we increase the input by two times and the output is also increasing by two times, that situation is called constant returns to scale. And the third situation that is possible, the third scenario is decreasing returns to scale. If we increase the input by two times, if we increase the input by two times, and the output...
Sir, your voice is breaking.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I think it will become clear now. If we increase the input by two times and the output is increasing by less than two times, that situation is called decreasing returns to scale. So these are three possible scenarios. Increasing returns to scale, constant returns to scale, and decreasing returns to scale. Again, I'm repeating these three scenarios. In the first situation, if we increase the input by double, if we double the input, the output increases by more than double. The increase in the output is more than double. That situation is called increasing returns to scale. And if the change in the input and the output is same, that situation is called constant returns to scale. And if the output, the change in the output is less than the change in the input, that situation is called decreasing returns to scale. So these are three possible situations in the long run. Now let us see by taking some examples. The first graph shows the constant returns to scale, where the distance between these isoquants are equal. In other words, if we are changing the input, the output is also changing by the same proportion, by the same amount, by the same magnitude. So that scenario is called constant returns to scale. And the second graph, this graph shows when there are increasing returns to scale as shown in B, The isobonds move closer together as inputs are increased along the line. So this is how we can show it graphically. Is my voice clear now? Can anybody please confirm?
Yes,
yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. The same phenomena can be expressed in terms of elasticity. Are you aware of the concept of elasticity? The change in the demand due to change in the price? So the same concept can be applied in the case of input-output relationship also. So if the output change in the output divided by change in all input, this can be termed as elasticity of output. So if the elasticity of the output is more than one, that situation is called increasing returns to scale. And if the elasticity of the output is equal to one, that situation is called constant returns to scale. And if the output elasticity is less than one, that implies decreasing returns to scale. So increasing returns to scale, decreasing and constant, all these three things can be defined in terms of output elasticity. Output elasticity, how can we calculate the output elasticity? The change in output divided by the change in input. The change normally is expressed in terms of percentage. So the percentage change in output divided by percentage change in all input, that will give us the figure that is known as elasticity. Elasticity. So if the elasticity is more than one, that situation is termed as increasing returns to scale. And if the elasticity is one, that situation is called constant returns to scale. And if the output elasticity is less than one, that situation can be termed as decreasing returns to scale. Graphically, this can be shown like this. If the units of input are the x-axis shows the units of input, that is labor, land, capital, which are inputs, all combinations of inputs. And the y-axis shows output, or total product. So if the change in the output is more than the change in the input, that situation is termed as increasing returns to. And if the change in the output is equal to the change in the input, that situation is called constant returns to scale. And if the change in the output, if the change in output is less than the change in input, that situation can be termed as decreasing returns to scale. So these are three possible scenarios which are possible in the long run. Depending on various factors, what are the factors that determine whether a particular industry or a particular company or organization is in the phase of increasing returns to scale or constant returns to scale or decreasing returns to scale? It depends on some important factors. We will talk about those factors later on. Now, the main factor that determines whether the organization is experiencing an increasing increasing or constant test of skill is because of economies of scale. In the long run, all costs are variable. There are no fixed costs in the long run because every input can be changed. In other words, in the long run, total cost equals variable cost because there is no fixed cost in the long run. So total cost and variable cost both will be same. And average total cost equals average variable cost. So whether we take the average variable cost or average total cost, it's the same thing. In the long run, the average long run average cost curve, in the long run, the average cost decreases initially. A curve that shows the lowest cost at which a firm is able to produce a given quantity of output in the long run when no inputs are fixed. So if the cost is divided by the number of output, that will give us the figure of average cost. And since in the long run every cost is variable, so whether we use the term long run average cost or simply long run cost, it's the same thing. Economies of scale means if the long run average cost is falling, that situation is called economies of scale. Or in other words, we can say that the firm is experiencing economies of scale, or the firm is taking advantage of economies of scale. Economies of scale means when we increase the level of production, the size of the production, and per unit cost decreases as a result of increase in the scale of the production, that situation is called economies of scale. If the long run average cost of a firm is reducing, is falling as a result of increase in the level of production, that situation is called economies of scale. Economies of scale. So if long run cost per unit, if the long run cost of producing one unit for a firm is decreasing, we can say that the firm is experiencing economies of scale. The firm is enjoying, the firm is reaping the benefit of economies of scale. What is economy of scale? In simple words, if a firm is producing less, the cost of producing per unit will be high. But if the scale of production is increased, say for example, if there is a firm which is producing 1,000 shoes per day, but if this same firm increases the scale of production from 1,000 shoes per day to 5,000 shoes per day, so as a result of increase in the scale, the cost of production per unit or per shoe will decrease. Normally it decreases. So that situation, if the cost per unit is decreasing, or if the long run average cost is decreasing, we can say that the firm is experiencing economies of scale. And the opposite concept of the economies of scale is diseconomies of scale. If the long run cost is increasing when we are increasing the level of production or the scale of production, we are producing more quantity of output, and as a result the cost per unit of production is increasing, that situation is called diseconomies of scale. So diseconomies of scale, the situation in which a firm's long run average cost rises as the firm increases output. So this is simple definition of economies of scale and base economies of scale. If the long run average cost is decreasing, the firm is experiencing economies of scale. And if the long run average cost per unit is increasing, that situation is called diseconomies of scale. So this is the some thing about economies of scale, which is a phenomena which is possible in the long run. This concept, economies and diseconomies of scale, is basically associated with long run production function. It's not associated with short run production. So long run average cost, as we talked that if the firm is experiencing economies of scale, the long run marginal cost as well as long run average cost both will decrease. So look here, till this point, this is point A, the long run average cost is decreasing. In other words, the firm is experiencing economies of scale. Economies of scale. So till the point A, the firm will experience economies of scale, and beyond A, the marginal cost as well as long run average cost has started increasing from this point onwards. Both average cost and marginal cost are increasing, and so this proportion is diseconomies of scale. Diseconomies of scale. So the area before A is economies of scale. And the area which is on the right side of the A point is diseconomies of scale. So this is this area is for economies of scale, and this area is for diseconomies of scale. Why? Because in this area, the long run average cost is falling, and in this area, the long run average cost is increasing. Is this clear? Up to this point, is this clear?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Now let us take one example to understand the concept of economies of scale. In front of you, a table is visible in front of you, and two scales are given. So the input in the first scale is 5 units of capital, 3 units of labor, 3 units of land, and 4 units of labor. If we are using these three inputs, the output is 100 units. In the second scale, the input has been doubled from 5 to 10, 3 to 6, 4 to 8, 10, 6, 8, and the output is 300. Now you have been asked to calculate the total cost as well as average cost. And some additional information is given below. The cost per unit of capital is rupees 5, the cost of land is 8, and the cost of labor per unit is 2. So please calculate the total cost and tell me, multiply 5 by 5,
then 57.
57.
87.
87. Anybody else?
57.
Yes, 57. It will be 57. It will be 57. Now, what will be the average cost? Average cost, total cost divided by Q. This is the formula for
0.57.
Now repeat the same thing for scale B.
Mirza Mujid, 114.
And what will be the average cost?
0.38.
0.38, Muhammad Saad, very correct. Now, what you are observing in this output, the total cost will of course increase, but we have defined the economies of scale in terms of average cost. So average cost has reduced. Initially the average cost was 0.57 per unit. Now it is 0.38 per unit. So this situation, if the average cost is falling, that situation is called economies of scale. If we are increasing the level of production, and as a result, the average cost per unit is reducing, that situation is called economies of scale. And don't get confused between total cost and average cost. Total cost will always increase because we are changing, the level of production. So of course the total cost will increase, but we have to look at the average cost. If the average cost per unit is decreasing, we can state that the firm is experiencing a situation of economies of scale. The firm is enjoying economies of scale. The same thing. So doubling the scale of production, a rise of 100% has led to an increase in output of 200%. So the input has been increased by 100%, but the output has increased by 200%, from 100 to 300. Therefore, cost of production per unit has fallen from 0.57 to 0.38. Overall cost will rise, but unit cost will fall. Economies of scale, a situation in which output can be doubled for less than a doubling of cost. That situation is called economies of scale. We have already talked about that. And diseconomies of scale is a situation in which doubling of output requires more than doubling of the input. So increasing returns to scale, output more than doubles when the quantities of all input are doubled. And economies of scale, a doubling of output requires less than a doubling of cost. So in increasing returns to scale and economies of scale are both same thing. If the firm is experiencing economies of scale, then the relationship between input and output will be of the nature of increasing returns to scale. The curve will look like this. Instead of a straight line, it will go upwards. So this is increasing returns to scale. And if the line is straight, that is constant returns to scale. If the line is downward like this, the growth is declining in the output, that situation is called diseconomies of scale. The same concept of can be expressed in terms of elasticity. So So economies of scale are often measured in terms of the cost output elasticity. The elasticity of cost is the percentage change in the cost of production resulting from a 1% increase in the output. So change in cost divided by change in quantity of output. If cost elasticity is less than 1, that situation is called economies of scale. And if the cost elasticity is more than 1, that situation is called diseconomies of scale. And if both are equal, if the cost elasticity is 1, that situation is termed as, the firm is neither experiencing economies nor diseconomies of scale. So now you may recall the concept of diminishing returns to scale, which we talked about in the short-run production function. Prima facie, both charts and graphs look same. Why? Because initially the marginal cost decreases, then it starts falling. The same thing happens in the long-run production function, that initially the average cost decreases, then after some time, when the firm starts experiencing this economies of scale, the average cost starts increasing. Prima facie, they look slightly similar, but they are different, because diminishing returns to scale is a concept which is associated with the short-run production function, and the concept of economies and diseconomies of scale is a concept associated with the long-run. In the short run, some inputs are fixed. In the long run, every input is variable. Every input can be changed. And the decrease in the cost is primarily because of the economies of scale and diseconomies of scale in the long run, which is not the case in case of short run production. Now, we will start talking about the specific reasons why economies of scale works. What are the reasons behind economies of scale, and as well as the diseconomies of scale? So we will take up this in the next class. Now, some some of you were asking about the reading material. So, if you want to study these things in detail, there is a managerial economics book by Samuelson, which is the most widely used book in managerial economics by Samuelson. I have the soft copy of that book. So if you I may share this with you. So if you want to study this in detail, you may refer to that book. The selected topics that I am taking, you can study those topics from that book. Otherwise, these PPTs are very short and crispy, but the same concepts you want to study in detail, then you may refer to some books. Any question, any clarification? Has everybody typed his and her name in the chat box?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so yesterday I requested some of you to introduce themselves. So we completed till Jasmine. Jasmine is not present. So, Junaid Ali, can you
Alkum, sir.
Introduce yourself in a few words?
Hello, Assalamualaikum, sir.
Alaikum Salaam.
My name is Junaid Ali. I am from Aligarh and I have done BCA from Agra University.
introduce yourself in few words.
My name is Kanishka Sharma. I'm from Secunderabad.